So you don't know me, but hopefully you know the Bible. You can open your Bible to Ephesians chapter 4. I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. So we've been talking about unity this week, and the idea of unity is an awesome idea. Everybody loves it, and it's pretty easy to come together. You know, we come together one service like this, but we actually had to sit down and talk through all of the details of things. Things would start to get difficult. And unity is hard because people are difficult. And you guys probably figured that out already. Other people are difficult. And even worse is the fact that you're a people too, which means that you're difficult as well. And so it's people who are difficult with other people who are difficult, and all of these problems arise. You know, we also have an enemy that loves division, and we would not want to be unaware of his schemes. But we need unity. Not just we're called to it all over the place. The Bible's like commanding us to be one, to be unified, to be brothers and sisters. Jesus himself prayed, John 17:21, that they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. And whenever I am doing something that is working against unity in the church, I'm literally working against Jesus' very prayer to the Father. You know, we often complain, God, like, not answering our prayers, and, you know, maybe he'd answer our prayers a little more if we were, like, you know, doing what was an answer to his prayer. Now, Paul in Ephesians doesn't merely say, get along with each other. So our unity in Christ is not based upon some shared cultural experience, some shared background, some shared vaccination status, or political affiliation. You can laugh at that a little bit. I hope, you know, we're like, yeah, this is 2022. You know, we can laugh a little bit. Remember how crazy we got there for a little bit? We were like, you know, yeah, every time you ask somebody out to eat and dinner, it was like this big, like, thing. Oh, man. Our unity is radically rooted in Jesus Christ. There's one body. There's one Spirit. Just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of us all, who is over all and through all and in all. And Paul here roots unity in the triune Lord, Father, Spirit, and Son. And truly, as Christians, the only way that we can have any hope of true unity is in Jesus Christ. He is our, like, I was just walking around Toronto, and I'm like from, you know, Western kid, and I have no idea where I'm going. But as long as I can, like weave around, I can look, and I can see that giant, big, weird tower sticking up, and it's like, oh, I know how to get to the Blue Jays game. I just go that direction in our Christian lives. Like, Jesus is the CN Tower. We look to him, and we're going to grow closer together. Now, people can come together looking at other things. You know, you might be looking at some other tower. You can come together. You can have some sort of unity, but it's not the unity that we're called to. The only unity that we're called to is in the triune God. Now, today, we are going to look at, for a little bit, the career of Solomon. And I think Solomon's really endemic because we just talk about unity, we think about unity, but there is one person that you are responsible for most of all in life. Now, if you're a parent, you have kids too, but you're responsible for yourself and your spiritual journey. When you stand before the judgment seat of God, you're not going to be able to push like your dad or your friend in front, be like, he was like in charge of my spiritual life. No, it's going to be you that's going to be called to account. And in the life of Solomon, we see the breakdown of unity. Solomon, the king of Israel. So what was Solomon known for? We think of Solomon, we think of wisdom. Yeah, he was the wise guy. And I always wanted to be a wise guy. Like he was that guy. He prayed for wisdom. He wrote like the book of Proverbs, Song of Solomon. Like he literally wrote the inspired words of God. Now, at the end of his life, something happens. And it's represented by this kind of prophetic oracle. There's a prophet named Ahijah, and he goes to a man named Jeroboam. Jeroboam is going to be important in the story of Kings, but Jeroboam, anyways, gets met, and Ahijah comes up to him. It's kind of weird. He comes up to him, and he just kind of like grabs hold of his clothing. Now, I'd feel a little weird, someone grabbed hold of the clothing. And then he like tore it. My wife said, like, every time you rip off clothing in a sermon, it doesn't go well, so hopefully this breaks the trend. So he takes it, and I like this shirt still, so I'm not going to rip it into 12 pieces, and I'm probably not strong enough anyways. And he rips his new shirt into 12 pieces, and then he speaks the judgment of God. And he said to Jeroboam, this is 1 Kings 11:31. Take for yourself 10 pieces. For thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, behold, I am about to tear the kingdom from the hand of Solomon, and I will give you 10 tribes. Now, this division would be terrible. The nation of Israel, which was united, the 12 tribes dwelling together, how blessed it is when brothers dwell in unity, would be torn apart into two different sections, and these sections would get picked off one by one until the whole nation, first the north by the Assyrians and the south by the Babylonians, would go off into exile. Now, what led to this? We back up in the story just a second, we get to 1 Kings 11. Love got them into this. Now, King Solomon loved many foreign women, along with the daughter of Pharaoh, Moabite, Ammonite, Edomite, Sidonian, and Hittite women, from the nations concerning which the Lord had said to the people of Israel, you shall not enter into marriage with them, neither shall they with you, for surely they will turn away your heart after their gods. Solomon clung to these in love. He had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines. And his wives turned away his heart. Now I know what you're thinking, like 1,000? Like really, Solomon? Every guy is thinking, like you know how this works. It's like 936, and you're just like, man, that number 1,000 up there. It's just like getting 1,000 hits. Well, let's. How did this fall happen? It's four things. One, he disobeyed the direct command of God. It's in Deuteronomy 7. It's like they had these laws concerning you can't marry these particular people from this particular nation because of God's desire for Israel to be a distinct nation. But Solomon was like, God, you know, it's just that one little verse in Deuteronomy 7. Who even reads Deuteronomy anymore? And then he was like, there's probably two things going on. One is kind of the simple reason, why would you have 1,000 wives? It's like, she's pretty hot, like that girl. And then you're walking along, she's pretty hot too, and like that girl. Well, the second, which maybe we shouldn't overlook, is there's kind of a political sphere here. where he's marrying these women to develop these alliances so that he increases in power. Now, God has promised him that God is going to bless him and keep him in all things if he follows in the law of Moses. And yet he is like, yeah, God, you know, that's kind of a far off promise. I think I'm going to do this my own way, plus get the hot chicks. God knows what he's doing when he gives us commands. We might think that this is just sort of like something holding us back, restraining us from living our best life now, but God knows what he's doing. And those who ignore God's teaching on everything, including sexuality, will soon find themselves in a very terrible place. Now, there's also the deal, the whole like thousand wives here, and this is, you know, when I was a teenager, we'd be like asking the Sunday school teacher, it's like, can we have like 40 wives? Because like in the Bible, in the Old Testament, they have a bunch of wives. And I'm like, and that seemed like convincing when I was a kid, until I actually read the Bible again more, and I was like, oh yeah, they had polygamy in the Old Testament, and it's universally terrible. Like, this is a bad story. It's the downfall of the nation because of polygamy. And by the way, God created Adam and Eve, not Adam and Eve and another girl, another girl, another girl. Like, that is apart from God's design, which is what Jesus points to when he talks about marriage. In verse 3, don't miss, it says, he had 700 wives, princesses, 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. Like, turned his heart. In the Bible, a heart is the source of motivation. It's kind of our will and our desires together. It is the thing that causes us to do what we're going to do. And his heart was turned because he had made himself a literal, like, small village of people around him, women whom he was, you know, intimately related to, who were worshiping other gods. And this surrounding himself with these eventually turned his attention, turned his heart away from the Lord. Well, the same thing happens with us if we are surrounded by people and influences and media that changes our hearts over time. You know, I've been on a couple canoe trips in my life, and one of the canoe trips we've done it with like young people in my old church, and we go up these rivers, and we paddle up the rivers. And the first day is so hard because we have to paddle up the rivers. You ever paddle up a river? Paddling up a river is very difficult because you're going against the current all the time. Now, you turn around, you go downstream, it's really easy. Now, in your Christian life, you can have some control of the currents around you. Now, for those who were at family camp this week, you know, being spiritually encouraged at family camp, like, it's hard to avoid. The reason why it's hard to avoid is there's Christians all around you. There are people, you know, waving their arms, giving, you know, messages twice a day. And all of these things kind of carry us along downstream. You know, all you have to do, you know, if you're going downstream, just paddle a little bit, keep going. But if the influencers are opposed to you, if you are in life and you're surrounded by, well, let's think of the things we could be surrounded by. Like, it could be people, or it could be like all the people we interact with on our little magic boxes on Facebook or YouTube or, like, God forbid, literally Netflix. You've spent half an hour on social media and 45 minutes on Netflix a week. You're going to be spending 5.5 hours with mostly godless influences every single week. Mostly godless influences. And all of that time you're spending is paddling upstream. Because you're gonna watch it, like these things, because they subtly influence us in ways that we don't quite understand. Whoever walks with the wise becomes wise. Now, the awesome thing is, as believers, we can actually tilt those streams a little bit by the decisions that we make day by day. Like a decision like coming to family camp. I was like, I'm tilting the streams for a little bit. Like the decision of deleting that app from my phone that is sucking my time, making me anxious and miserable, and making my marriage worse. It's like, why do we actively sabotage ourselves so much? I said, okay, why do we? Why do I actively sabotage myself by being on Facebook too much? Ugh. Yeah. And chess. You get to feel intellectual when you're just playing a game, moving dots around, just like the teenagers with their like gun shooting bang bang games. But anyways. We can tilt the stream by turning off these influences and by turning on fellowship. You go home to your church right now, like there are going to be small groups. Maybe starting in the fall. Stay tuned. September. There's prayer meetings probably on Wednesday night at our church. I don't know what it is at your church, probably prayer meetings. If there's not, bug your pastor to start one. Make him feel guilty if he doesn't come. Go find somebody you think, like, that is somebody that, like, I would like my life to look like them. And say, hey, you know, I'd really like to sit down and meet with you once a week just to pray, maybe talk about a book, talk about the Bible, talk about our week, have coffee. Whoever walks with the wise becomes wise. The companion of fools suffers harm. And if we surround ourselves with influences that are carrying us downstream in the right direction, like spiritual life becomes a lot easier when we're just keeping the course, like keeping from going into the bushes on the side. I once went on a canoe trip where you hit the bushes on the side and spiders would just like drop down on you. And it's like, all you have to do is steer to keep, you know, away from the spiders at the edge of the shore. We can make our lives easier by not marrying the 1,000 foreign women. It's a decision that we can make. Okay. Fourth, Solomon clung to these in love. Oh, actually, so before I get there, so I'm just like talking about like how you can control that. And if you're thinking, man, I'd really like to do that, but I'm always like not doing it. So this is a trick, you can do it. Okay, you probably have a magic black box somewhere around. My wife called this my black wife for a bit. Yeah, you don't want to be in that conversation, but anyways. You can take it out, and you can type in like a thing, like 8 o'clock in the morning, type in, find more Christian community, and then go from the once down to daily, and make an alarm go off, and just make it blare at you until you actually do it and find more community. Because this is such an amazing key thing. All right, so final thing, Solomon clung to these in love. I think of Solomon as the first guy who put up a love is love poster, and the kingdom divided because of it. Your loves can often get you into more trouble than the things that you even hate, and the things you hate can get you into a lot of trouble as well. If you love respect and attention, you're going to be tempted to steal God's glory. If you love relationships, you may pursue them outside of God's command and timing. If you love money, well, I just quote the Bible. The Bible says the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Love is only good when it's pursued under God's command, in God's timing, according to God's way. Solomon began with such promise, but he was led wildly astray by the things he loved. To the point where, in verse 7, 11:7, then Solomon built a high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, and for Moloch, the abomination of the Ammonites, on the mountain east of Jerusalem. You know what's the mountain east of Jerusalem? This is like the Mount of Olives. Like he's literally defiling the place where the Messiah, the true son of David, would come and reclaim with his prayers. So how did he go so wrong? Because that's the question we should ask, because we're standing here, like we're in like church here. We're doing like, you're doing great today. You are in the right place. But the people who start in the right place don't always end in the right place. So where did Solomon go wrong? He had a stellar career. He built the temple, and he asked for wisdom instead of the death of his enemies. He was lauded by the Queen of Sheba for his wisdom. He wrote the Song of Solomon, and he even wrote the words that he failed to live up to. Yeah. My wife's like, how many sermons have you preached you failed to live up to? Yeah, a lot. Proverbs 13:20, whoever walks with the wise becomes wise, but the companion of fools will suffer harm. I wonder if he went from writing that to go visit his Hittite wife. Because it's not like he did all of these good things and then at the end of his life and said, oh yeah, I'm going to go marry 1,000 foreign women. The first thing that Solomon does when he solidifies his reign, 1 Kings 3, is this. And the Bible makes sure you know it. Solomon made a marriage alliance with Pharaoh, king of Egypt. He took Pharaoh's daughter and brought her into the city of David until he had finished building his own house and the house of the Lord. By the way, he kind of did his own house before the house of the Lord, which is a whole other thing, and the wall around Jerusalem. But it says, verse 3, Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of David, his father. A Solomon at the age of maybe 20, maybe some like 20, 21, he loved the Lord. He was following in his way, but the seed of the thing that was going to destroy him was already in his house. The seed of the thing that's going to destroy him. Now, there is someone here right today that has the seed of their own destruction in their house right now. Maybe like Solomon, you're doing a lot of good things for God. Heck, maybe you're even up preaching here. You may, like Solomon, love the Lord. But maybe there's a little seed in there somewhere. Something maybe that looks like kind of good. I mean, it's a love of, you know, relationships or praise or friends or status or Marvel movies. You know, things that aren't bad in themselves. Except like Iron Man 2 and, you know, Captain Marvel. There were some bad ones, but that's DC. They're all bad. You know, maybe it is something bad and small and you don't see it. You know, porn or prostitutes, I don't know, drugs. Loves that right now in your life that feel kind of harmless. Like, God, this thing, you know, as long as I keep this seed just at this like little, like it's like here, doing better than a lot of people. I'm not Hitler yet. But these seeds, if you grow and feed them, if you walk with them, the river of this world will, moment by moment, even when you feel like you're paddling against the current, be taking you downstream. Solomon was right. The companion of fools will suffer. And this is, like, I say this and I feel convicted, and I hope some people are convicted, you know, maybe if you don't know where the seeds are, it's like, where are the seeds? But on the flip side, like, there's a counter example to Solomon. And you don't have to go very far, and we're moving backwards here. All you have to do is go to Solomon's father, David. Because David, like, he had some bad seeds that grew up that eventually led to a pretty giant tree of misfortune in his heart that led to, I don't know, adultery, murder. And you probably haven't gotten seeds that big if you're still here. You know, maybe. But even if David, with his heart, came back to God and prayed, and you can too, if you're feeling like you're getting swept away by the world this very day, all you need to do is reach out in the prayer. You flip over Psalm 51. This is David's prayer after he went into Bathsheba. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. You don't have to feel like, man, I'm like so bad from God. I'm just too bad here. You need to know that God is waiting to forgive you. He went to the cross so that he would have a superabundance of forgiveness to apply for your very sin. Have mercy on me, O God. The power to forgive all your sin. And that's the hope of the gospel every day. You're never too far to turn. And he is there to wash you, and you will be whiter than snow. He is there to create in you a, what's the thing that gets bad when our heart goes to a bad heart? To create in you a clean heart and renew a right spirit in you. But turn back now while your heart still can. Because, like, literally, no matter how far you go, if you turn back to God, like, there is forgiveness there. But there's one day you let the seeds of destruction grow and you will no longer feel like turning back again. It's a horrible place to be. Now, unity starts with hearts that are turned back to God. And it's shattered by hearts that turn away. So let's turn again to God this very day. Let's pray.